extend a warm welcome to Atom Miguyan and Artine Kanto.
So we thought that really this is very, very loose and open, but you know, we thought since you know we really the themes and the ideas and the passion for this is something that we've been working together on for a long time and many things for this, that if there's any questions that Arsene should also is open to questions as well. So
maybe we can start with, you know, how you met Anik Sıpkın and, you know, the relation with your Armenian origins. Both, I mean, you were born in Cairo, Egypt, and you were born in Lebanon. You arrived in Canada at the age of 3 and at the age of 17. So,
yeah, I mean, we had very different upbringings. My parents decided to move to the west coast of Canada, and we were really the only Armenian family there. There was no community to speak of. There were a few Armenians, but no community. So I was raised in a very assimilated way, and I was aware of my background, and I knew the basic points of what it meant to be Armenian, and I knew the idea of the history in a folkloric way, but nothing specific, until I went to Toronto at the age of 18 to study international relations. I didn't study film. And I became involved with the Armenian Student Association at the university, and it was an extraordinary time to be involved, because at that point there was a Armenian militant action, like it's being referred to here in the film with Rafi's father.
Yeah.
So there was these, and it was a very shocking time to enter into the question of the identity and the history, because it was all pitched at such a high, intense level. And so that was my upbringing.
We actually met about 9 years after I moved with my family from Beirut because of the civil war in 1975. So we left for Canada, where I had already a family from my mother's side from the early mid-60s. They had already moved. So we went for a temporary period to avoid the civil war, thinking that it was going to last maybe a year or so. It lasted 15 years, and we never went back to Lebanon, where there was a very large Armenian community. I was brought up in that community, unlike Adam, as he said, with a very clear sense of the history and the identity of an Armenian diasporan community.
Speaking the language.
Speaking the language, absolutely. At the time, we had 42 schools in Beirut, which were Armenian schools, where, of course, we had to learn also the official language of the country, which was Arabic and French, but Armenian was also the language of the family. My family, we spoke with also friends and so on. So I came from a community where I was sort of very clearly, as a Lebanese Armenian, identifying myself with my Armenian roots and origins. My parents were also born in Lebanon, but my grandparents came from historic Armenia, which is present-day Eastern Turkey, referred to geographically as Anatolia. So they were survivors, and I was brought up in an environment of references and conversations about their experiences, but you know, very erratic. But I think learning about the history and this notion of identity beyond the language was based on my education in terms of the schools I went to, of course, the community as in cultural centers. So when I came to Montreal, I did have the language of this new environment, which was French. But I continued to live in the within the Armenian community, who had immigrated in the early 60s with the nationalization of Egypt from Egypt. So there were very few Armenians from Lebanon or Syria at that point. They were mostly like Adam's parents from Egypt. But I did not meet Atom during those first 9 years in Montreal. I didn't meet him in 1984. or 83, end of 83.
Yeah. So, that's an audition, no?
At an audition where I was doing theater, because I did my theater studies in Montreal, but I was doing Armenian community theater, which was a very common cultural activity. We had many groups, companies within the community, but it was amateur theater because at that point I was doing my master's already in political science. So what we did not know about each other is that we were both interested. Adam did international relations studies and I was doing political science in that sense, and we met in 1984 when I was doing a rehearsal for The Mousetrap, Agatha Christie's work, in Armenian. And then we met again the next day in another Armenian community theater production of Othello, again in Armenian. And that's where we actually had our first conversation, and I was offered an audition, kind of improvised in that sense, and eventually I got the part for Next of Kin, which is Adam's first feature, and we shot it in Toronto in 1984. The rest is history, as they say.
You produced Calendar together. I'm curious to know how Calendar has been sort of something that has helped you throughout the process of Ararat, and what was the influence of Calendar in creating Ararat?
Well, Calendar was very important. This is a very small film that we made in Armenia with ZDF.
Just before Exotica that was showing you.
It was very important for me as a filmmaker because it was really a sketch of using a more prismatic structure. It's about a photographer who goes to Armenia to shoot 12 calendar images for a calendar. And over the course of these 12 images, and it's really just 12 beautiful static shots from the point of view of his camera, he watches his relationship fall apart. His wife, played by Arsene, falls in love with the guide who's taking them from church to church. And he's kind of paralyzed by this. So it's then there was no real script. We basically had this concept, and we shot these 12 scenes, largely improvised. There was the concept, but not the dialogue. It was just sort of improvised. And then I had the rare opportunity to come back, look at the material, and respond to it with these other scenes that we were going to shoot in Toronto. So this type of filmmaking was just luxurious because it was Das kleine Fernsehspiel at the time, and they gave us this small grant, and they said the film can be 40 minutes or an hour and a half, it doesn't matter, but just, you know, make it, you know, explore the idea. So it was a really rare opportunity, and we really took advantage of this. And the film is dealing with questions of identity, and certainly landscape and national consciousness, because my character, I'm played the photographer, I play someone like myself who's very assimilated, wouldn't have gone to Armenia if he didn't have this assignment.
Don't speak the language.
I don't speak the language. I speak it better than the character, but certainly not anywhere near fluent. And Arsene's character is someone like Arsene, who was raised in the community, is coming back to this place that has been set up as a fantasy for her, because of her upbringing. And then the guide is someone who's rooted in that place. So Ararat is dealing with many different issues. I mean, there's something almost very pure and naive and actually almost not even political about Calendar. You don't necessarily need to know it's Armenia to absorb the film. It could be, it's about that state of losing a relationship, and about losing it in a particular space where there's a whole other, it's almost as though my character feels that she deserves, that the person that I'm with deserves to be somewhere else. Like, is enriching herself by being in this place, and, you know, the emotional consequences of letting that person go in front of your eyes. So, and then the torment, the torturing. I come back and there's these 12 scenes in my apartment in Toronto, where I'm hiring escorts to basically torture me, to basically humiliate me and speak to, if you haven't seen the film. But that idea of ritualized torture, that feeds into Exotica. you know, the idea of Francis Brown going to this nightclub night after night, having these tortured conversations, kind of this weird therapy sessions
with Christina.
That evolved from Calendar. So I think there's a direct link between the themes of those two films. Ararat is, actually there's a closer link of the themes with Ararat with my second feature, which is Family Viewing, which is also dealing with this notion of
disappearance,
but also of liberation, of trying to liberate a culture through the repository of this grandmother. You know, if those of you who don't know these films, I mean, they are available they're all available through Artificial Eye. There's a set, but I guess you can, I hate to say this, but I think you can probably download them from the, anyway, so it's like, I'm the last person to say it.
Well, just to come back to the parallel between Calendar and Ararat, probably they're both dealing, obviously, with the question of identity, but Calendar is much more about the individual sense of that identity and the exploration of that identity from really personal perspective, whereas Ararat is a more collective sort of embodiment of that identity, which deals much more directly, therefore, with the notion of history also, and how history has traveled from generation to generation. There is something more stratified in terms of the time of the understanding of this question of identity in Ararat, whereas in Calendar, it is much more fluid for the
viewer. Hazard also, I mean, we could see the images of the sheep can be, we don't know exactly what's planned and what's, you know, coming like out of nowhere, well, just by chance.
I mean, that to me, see, again, I love that type of filmmaking, because that shot of the sheep, for filmmakers here, I knew that shot was really important when I shot it. I knew it was very important when I cut it, when I was cutting the film, and I knew it had to be repeated at the end of the film, but I didn't know why. And it was only when I was almost mixing the film, because it was just, there was nothing there. And I remember calling Arsene and saying, you have to come to the mixing studio and record this conversation. And that conversation where she actually is admitting that that the relationship is over, is then played as a phone message over that shot. So you realize that shot that we saw at the beginning is the moment where the relationship actually ended. I didn't know that as I was using it. So this type of filmmaking is so liberating when you're actually just, you don't have the blueprint of a script,
yeah, exactly.
And you're able to just almost sculpturally use imagery to tell a story in a very visceral way. But as we all know, that's not very common, because to get funding you need a script.
Yeah, exactly, absolutely.
Right.
And it's just when I look at, when I was watching Ararat and watching the images that Rafi shot in Armenia, I felt there was an emotion that's quite distinct. I mean, it's like a counterpart of the emotion that's on screen,
right.
Proposed or imposed by the director, by Charles Nouveau. So I felt, you know, I felt this link with the images of, in Calendar, of the churches also.
Well, you know, the thing about Ararat is that it's a very intimate, it's basically a film about two families. There's the family Christopher Plummer and his son, and there's the family of Arsene and her son, and how both of these families confront two very different works of art. One is a masterpiece. It's the painting of the artist and his mother by Arshil Gorky, the most famous survivor of the Armenian genocide. And the other one, from what we can see, is probably a work of cinematic kitsch, right? It's like, you know, this film within the film. But the film that Aznavour is making is probably not going to go anywhere. It's like a very old-fashioned type of historic epic. So here we have a work of art that's too literal, this film within the film, of what it's showing. And then Gorky's painting, which is extraordinary because it is the most amazing statement of trauma, and yet it's mysterious. It's based on this photograph that was taken, you know the story, you saw the film. But you know, this moment of the abstracted hands is this portal into a whole new level of consciousness in this new country, America. I was just at the Whitney, and they have the painting at the Whitney, And you realize that with that gesture, Gorky, you know, along with de Kooning and Pollock, basically forged a whole new voice in America that didn't exist before. Interesting abstract expressionism. Every other art form in America before was derivative of something in Europe. You know, you look at in the Whitney, which is all about American art, every artist before, even Hopper, the type of realism is based in a European tradition. But that painting, and I would even say like that gesture, just kind of is a portal into this new space. And it's amazing that it's the conduit is coming from a traumatized immigrant who could not address the nature of this catastrophe he went through. You know, so it's a very significant painting, and yet the movie, which shows all these literal images, I don't think is very significant ultimately at all.
Yeah, that's why you show also the premiere. It feels that feels like what is going to endure is actually Rafi and his testimony as the need to tell the story rather than the film that is already at the premiere. So it gives a moment of time that is passing already.
Yeah, I think that's very, very true. I think that ultimately history is what is expressed in conversations. You know, it's histories which are understood on a one-to-one level. But very often when we rely on state versions of history and official histories, you know, there's lots of agendas. And that the real agendas that stick are the emotional ones, the ones of the heart between two people.
But also it says something about what we have come to really entrust in cinema about telling stories and telling truth, telling history. So the film within the film is the one that has the it has that self-given mandate of telling history in its factual sort of expression. But then it's an interesting commentary on how the development of cinema in terms of when you would have chosen to do that kind of style of film, because also cinema has its own sort of chronology of what we have shown when and how. With the Armenian genocide as a historical event, it has been very, very little documented, if at all. The only film that came out right after the genocide was in 1919 in the United States, called Auction of Souls or Ravage Armenia, based on the testimony of a survivor, which became a bestseller book. And it was made into a film that was using the form of telling the factual, like, image-based chronology of events. And it was a huge success at the time because people were looking at cinema with a particular expectation of what image should do. And the topic was also very timely. I mean, everyone knew. It was just at the end of the First World War. America knew, Europe knew. But eventually, storytelling in cinema formally also developed, but not, we didn't have any further films to come and be added to that repertoire of Armenian genocide storytelling. So when you make a film in 2002, or say, I don't know, when Charles Aznavour is making his film in Ararat, to use that format, which was meaningful, let's say in the 20s or 30s, it was no longer sort of interest to the viewer to hear about story that way. So I think so Ararat is very significant also, not only about telling about denial about the Armenian genocide as a further development of the genocide or the continuation of it, but also how cinema itself has to have its own language properly positioned so that you can tell the story.
I think the other thing that's really odd about this film is we were talking about individuals exchanging history. The boy, Rafi, who's telling the story to Christopher Plummer, never asks himself, why is this customs officer spending so much time with him? And what he doesn't know is the whole history of, like, this man whose son has come out, who's trying to understand this huge paradigm shift in his life, in his familial relationship. Who's being accused by his son of being intolerant, and is really lonely, like is trying to understand, is he tolerant or not? And he's testing himself with this boy. He's, you know, it's his last night, he's gonna be retiring, and he has all the time in the world. So the boy never once, and this is what's odd, even though this man changes his life, you know, he could have been a criminal, he could have taken the court, he has absolved himself, and maybe later on in his life, Rafi will wonder, well, what happened that night? Why was that man spending so much time? But because he's so wrapped up in telling his version of the story and dignifying himself, he's not asking the obvious question. That to me is also really odd in the film, that we have these characters who are transformed or distorted by this trauma in unexpected ways. I mean, you could say he's youthful, but also when you look at Ani's character, you know, the way that she has actually inherited this denialism, the way she denies, you know, the sister, the daughter-in-law, you know, the right for the daughter to actually, you know, there's this moment that she has access to, and she's not going to give that to the daughter because she doesn't need to.
That's what she says, yes. I don't need to.
Yeah. So it's odd, you know, the reality, and maybe what makes the film, you know, challenging is that the reality is traumatized people very often they exhibit some of the characteristics of the perpetrator. They actually cannot help but actually absorb some of that, even though it's against their own self-interest. So I wanted the film to express that as well.
And I think that the character also of the custom officer is something that's quite recurrent, I mean, in your films, in Exotica, I think it also opens the film.
Well, look, I think as a kid coming into Canada, that must have been a huge moment for me, because it's in the new film as well, Remember, which we're premiering
in Venice.
Yeah. There's a scene of the customs officer as well, and I think that something must have happened as we came to Canada. And I must have witnessed something primal at the customs office, because it's, to me, this extraordinary moment where you're being given entry into a country. I must have observed my parents being nervous, or something must have happened that really left a mark on me. You know, it's because it is a strange thing. It's odd because in the new film, Christopher Plummer is dealing with Canada Customs himself from the other side, and he's having trouble getting in to Canada, and it didn't even occur to me until we finished shooting it. So it's, I find it's interesting, Freud is correct, that if your basic personality, if everything that you are to become is formed before the age of 3, your world is formed by all those experiences, well then that's the age I came to Canada. So there's a whole set of experiences that I'm carrying from a time that I'm not conscious of. And there's no link to that because I was separated from that world completely. So customs must be like quite representative.
There's also quite often your films, the cross.
Right.
Very often, all the color green. Is it something that you integrate like consciously in your film?
Well, color coding is. I mean, color is one of the most valuable, you know, things that you, as a filmmaker, it's part of the palette that you work with the designer. It's as important as composition and the clothes that characters wear. I mean, to me, that's an amazing.
Asine is dressed in black, like she's 2 times widow in.
But these are really important choices these characters make. Like, and I think that when you're doing a costume fitting, I mean, what that character decides to put on that morning, you know, how they choose to present themselves to the world, is an incredible insight as to who they are. So there's nothing casual about what they're wearing. You know, I just think that when you're dealing with any sort of drama, the choice of what the person is wearing, the color choice they're making, everything is an insight into who they are. And those are very important conversations to have with your costume designer, and certainly with the actors and the costume designer.
Yeah, because again, I mean, it's not only appearance is also about identity. I mean, appearance is very much, we can neglect appearance, but even that neglect is a commitment to who we want to be. I mean, in the case of Ani, she's also an art historian, and as we know, there is a, I think it's quite universal, or at least in the Western world, the notion of an art historian or someone being in the arts, the black is a recurrent sort of uniform. You see it from...
Quite often in cinema.
Yes, in cinema. So... within the conversation with the costume designer, there was this notion of she's an art historian, but also the notion of mourning, which was really part of, but without her wanting really to make that statement, because also there is a silence about between her and her son about the history of the father, and that silence is a very complicated one. It's a dark place, and my favorite scene, of course, I mean, is the scene when at the breakfast scene where the mother and son talk. And still today, when I look at the film, that I'm filled with emotion, not because of his or my performance, of course, but that situation is a very moving one, where you have to go to this dark place where there is almost a sort of wanting to not address something that you cannot live with, which is the action of the father, but at the same time, the pain and of the loss of this man as a partner in life, but also as the father figure for the son. So and we all have in these histories of identities where we come from trauma, also intergenerational trauma, not firsthand necessarily trauma, but intergenerational trauma, where figure, metaphoric figure, or the symbolism of authority and transition is disrupted. And in this case, it's in that generation is the father figure, so, and the man. So there is a darkness there as well, which is kept in the body.
And it's beautiful. Body. It's also like a political questioning. Is he a freedom fighter or is he a terrorist? I mean,
it depends on the perspective that you're gonna put on history, right? My feeling was that I have to say that scene is also very significant, especially when we showed it in Yerevan in Armenia, because I come from that generation where the actions were taken, those actions belong to my generation in Lebanon, in the Middle East. We were 15, 16, 17, you know, and we realized that the genocide that was our history, our family's history, was referred to very casually as the forgotten genocide. And this became a very big issue.
Like Ilyas Kotas in the film, like the one that plays the character Ali.
Yes, absolutely.
Like he says, who knows? I mean, it's a new country.
And it was just, you know, something that we had to accept, and we did not accept, because we were still living with the survivors. We were still living with the fact that we were maybe ashamed that we survived. Therefore, the only way to come out of the shame was, or the guilt, that was to do something about that that history. And we realized that the only way we could get that history back on the table was to take the actions that we did take. You know, it didn't last very long, maybe maximum a period of 10 years, in the end of 70s and mid or end of 80s, somewhere around there. But I think what I want to say is that when we showed the film in Armenia in 2002, two of the people who had been freedom fighters, the activists, the militants, the fedayis, or the terrorists, which was becoming a very fashionable word again to define these kind of actions outside of war. A soldier is not a terrorist, even though they can commit war crimes, but an individual undertaking can be qualified as terrorism. So two of them who had been imprisoned because they were caught during those actions in the 80s, and they were also, they had lost sight, body, like they were handicapped and all that. They were living at that time in Yerevan. They had moved to Yerevan, and one of them had come to see the film. And I remember the most obsessive sort of thing for me was to find out what is he. And I knew that this one young man, we went to the same school together. I was a girl guide, he was a boy scout, so I had a family relationship. I knew exactly where he comes from. It was so important for me to know what he thought of that scene, that conversation between mother and son, because it was a whole history of the told and the untold that was at stake in that moment. Yeah. So that darkness is something that Ararat really addresses.
Yeah, and it echoes also to another scene in Ararat where there is Charles Aznavour film, and you see the father of the child that has just been killed. You know, that is filled with emotion and takes his machine gun and goes out, like in a clearly suicide gesture. And I like the cut, the editing, with having Rafi saying they were heroes. So this is also a political statement because
that's
it's
so
not
weird, because I hate that cut. It's the one thing in the film that I would have liked, I should have put that line over, because I find it, it's funny you mention that, because it's the one thing I would have preferred to have heard that over the scene of the father, and then cut back to Rafi after he says the line. We hear the line, but it not be Rafi saying it. It's so weird you mention that. It's like, because normally I'm so careful about these things, and when I watch
the
film,
why do you hate that cut?
I just think that word hero would have made more sense over the image. And then you're pulled out of it, as opposed to being pulled out, him commenting. But maybe that's what
well,
you like about
you
it. Maybe,
understand.
Maybe that's what you like about it. Maybe.
No, well, you understand that it's he's clearly not acting as a hero.
Yeah.
So you understand that it's very ambiguous. And what makes a difference between martyr and a hero?
So interesting.
It's ambiguity.
But this is the thing about filmmaking, right? These decisions are so specific. So we're talking about the costumes and everything, every color and every cut, every sound, and like I was watching *Son of Saul* yesterday, and I was like thinking, "Oh my God, this is so well directed!" And like I wanted a first feature, and like every camera placement, every cut, every sound. But there are so many decisions you have to make as a filmmaker, and you're responsible for all of them, So you're dealing with people who are watching so critically. It's quite amazing now because of, when I started making films, it was actually pre-VHS, so there was no way to go back and check things that easily. But now it's like people are obsessive about mistakes, obsessive about anything that's wrong, and you are responsible for that, and it's a bit terrifying, but it's also kind of exciting if you commit yourself to that task. Because you have to also, we're talking about calendar, you can't be rigid about it. You have to also, there are certain things that just happen because they flow in a certain way, and it's musical. You may not understand it completely.
But then it tickles.
Right. But that's a good example. That's an editing choice, and it's a film that uses voiceover and commentary, and whatever the decision was at that point, it was towards what you're saying, and maybe it's just a perspective change. People say, one of the really difficult things about digital editing is that it's so quick. You don't have time to reflect, and any change that you make becomes invisible, and you don't know what the previous choice was. When you were editing on film, you used to see the splices and you used to be reminded of where the cuts were.
Yeah.
But now it's like so clean all the time, and it's an exciting process, but it's also it doesn't give as much time to think about things.
Unless you take the time.
Unless you create that time.
But I mean, I'm not a filmmaker, but I think the most exciting part of filmmaking is the editing process, because it is your last chance, perhaps, but it's a hell of a chance to retell what you intended from the idea to the script to the shooting, and then to have, you can completely transform your film through the editing process. And I have observed that unfortunately it has become much more a technical stage of filmmaking, and that we have lost for all kinds of reasons, and mostly probably over again and again because of financial time, finances, and so on, purposes. But the editing is the place where you can take most of the time to refine. It doesn't matter what you have, and you can have catastrophes of what you have shot or wrong, maybe scripting of it, but editing can give you such an incredible opportunity to revisit and create altogether something else. I mean, but also there is something about editing that is interesting, I find, is this, again, observing it from the outside, not as a filmmaker, but I've always wondered why often editing is given to the editor as a technician. Why is it that the filmmaker who can end up writing his script, who can end up producing his film, who does direct his film, can get involved in the cinematography, they don't get more often involved also in the editing, which is the most sort of beautiful. Well, I don't know how often they come and check.
No, the filmmaker, it depends on the relationship you have, but it is interesting. I mean, there are filmmakers who are there all the time,
yeah.
And then there are filmmakers who just sort of like, you know, it also depends on the style of the shooting as well.
So how do you work? I mean, you work with a very consistent team of person and with your editor?
It depends on this film. I mean, there are films that I've edited myself, like a Calendar or Citadel, or like films where I know exactly where I want the cuts to be, and or I need that to be a very personal, you know, intimate experience.
Well, Citadel was when you all went to Lebanon.
That's right.
Personal.
Very personal. But I find that when I'm shooting drama and conversations, there's an editor I work with, and I think her response to the balance of dialogue, I really appreciate having that other view. Because I've written the script, I can certainly then react to that cut, the cutting, but I'd like to see how someone else sort of like feels out the actual flow. Because, you know, the cutting is not about, as even more important than who is saying the line, is when you're withholding and you're seeing the reaction of another actor, you know, having something said to them, or processing what that information is. So, and certainly while I'm shooting, I can't be in the editing room, you know. So it's good to have someone else lay that out, so I can actually check that and measure other things that I'm shooting as I'm going along. Now, I know that there are filmmakers who are editing on their, on their computer as they're shooting as well. They go to the trailer and they're kind of doing a rough edit. I'm not at that place, you know.
But your editor starts working on the film every day of the shooting.
Depending on the film, but for the larger films, yes. Because you also you understand that with the larger films, because you have a larger budget, you also have insurance issues, and you have people who need to know that you're getting the material that you need, and you need to know if there are problems, and if you have to reshoot. So it would be way too risky not to go into the editing while you're shooting.
So while you're shooting, she is editing the scenes that you've shot. And when do you actually watch what she's editing?
I'm watching scenes all along, but then I give myself after the shoot a week, and then I watch the assembly of all the material together. I'm not watching the whole thing together until after the shoot, and then it's and that's a frightening process, because it's usually when you're most depressed, right? Because you see what you have, and you're not seeing it though with the music that you might have in mind or the sound you might have in mind. And you have to brace yourself, because that it can be really shocking. In the case of The Sweet Hereafter, the film that you're going to see tomorrow, which is my most critically acclaimed film, that was the worst experience ever, because my whole strategy didn't work. Like, the way it was written was a complete failure. So it had to be completely restructured in the editing. And And actually, it's hard to say until you've seen the film, but the thing that makes the film so interesting was a way of shooting that I wouldn't have done if the mistake hadn't been made. The mistake was that when you see the film, it started with the bus. Oh, I'm giving it away. Okay. But anyway, so that was a situation where the whole thing was reshaped during the editing, but because it was the plan didn't work at all. And so, you know, it's...
Yeah, that's the hazard part of the film.
Yeah.
Well, we have with us the campus alumni, which theme this year is Wonder Matters. So I was curious reading the theme because, wonder can be understood in different ways, but, I mean, it feels you like the audience, the viewers, to wonder about your characters, what your characters are holding back, as you were saying. So is it something that you want to talk about, like your relation with the audience in terms of being kind of teasing the audience so that they can actually participate, wonder about?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's why Exotica is really interesting, because you're wondering what that conversation is about. Like, no one goes into a strip club and hires a dancer and then tortures themselves that way. Like, it doesn't make, you know, like, why are they so unhappy during, you know, this lap dance? And why is the MC saying these strange things? And why, you know, and she's pregnant in this club? And what's the, like, it's a whole series of things that you can't understand. You're suddenly thrown into this movie. Wonder and also seduction is important, because I think you need to sort of be swept up in a world, which is probably most challenging with Era, because it's not immediately seductive, right? It feels a little bit like a melodrama at the beginning. You're not quite sure what the family. There's no connecting tissue.
You're not even sure that scenes of Gorky painting, you don't know if they're part of Charles Aznavour film or if
exactly, right. So you're really, and I used to feel, when you talk about wonder, I used to like think that was the great thing that you could do with cinema, is that you just plunge into a world and people have to figure out what their relationship is. But you have to understand that wonder came from a moment where cinema meant being in a room and you were committed to an hour and a half, so that you're in that space, you've read a review or you've been drawn to a film, and you're there for, you know, an hour and a half, and maybe for the first half hour you have no idea what's going on, and then gradually it begins to fit into place, and that can be very exciting. Well, the honest answer is you can't do that anymore. You know, I can't use that type of strategy, because I don't know if people are going to be committed to watching that film. And people are going to be watching it on small devices, and they're going to be distracted easily. So a lot of the wonder that brought me into cinema is not, it's difficult to sustain it. The thing that's still absolutely and exquisitely wondrous is the close-up, the phenomenon of the concentration on a human face. So when you look at something like Son of Saul, like, that is the wonder, is that the camera is able to focus on this, and you are wondering how much has that person relinquished of his own humanity, given this unfathomable job he has, you know, and you are hoping that there is still some element of humanity. So that is still will be wondrous. The relationship of a camera to a human face, the choice of lenses, of how you compose that face. But structurally, the devices that I'm using in these films is more rarefied now. I notice that when I watch certain movies that I loved, I don't know if those movies can still persist in a culture that's become transformed the way ours has. So wonder becomes more, it just changes, but you need it, I agree. You need to feel that there's, as a filmmaker, you need to feel there's something magic about what you are showing. That what you are showing is rare. and you have to harness your characters with landscapes or places which you think you are excited about. And you have to, if you don't have that excitement, then you're in trouble, you know. Sometimes, you know, you can get depressed on a set because it's not the way you want, but you have to find something that's going to keep that wonder. I don't know if that's how what you were talking about during the workshop, but it's, it is an important aspect. Yeah.
I was wondering if there were some questions from the audience.
Yes. Hello. You have been mentioning the strategy that you have been using, like at the beginning of the movie, we don't know anything about the characters. And now I was wondering, while you are writing the movie, while you're writing these stories, are they like set in a chronological order, or do you like mix those stories up later while you're editing or directing the movie?
Well, I think the screenplays suggest that they will be non-linear, but they're not necessarily non-linear in the way they are in the screenplay. So let's say the last film, Captive, which is also non-linear, but that adheres pretty much to the screenplay. Like I said, The Sweet Hereafter changes the screenplay completely. And Ararat was somewhere in between. I mean, there is that... there's the suggestion to the reader that it's not a linear form. Yeah. I think, you know, this is a good question because you do have to write a script that's going to attract people's interest, you need to, for instance, I'll give you, like, one of my favorite films is Persona. Read, if you like that film, which is a very sparse script, try and get your hands on Bergman's screenplay. Because the way he sets up that film, first of all, there's this weird montage at the beginning, which is completely, surreal, actually. You know, this strange soup of imagery. But the way he writes it in his screenplay is so beautiful, and basically the screenplay gives you the tone of what the film will be. So even though what follows might seem very cryptic, you get a sense from that first page of what the film might be like, because you do have to convey that to your funders and to your distributors, or your funding people. You have to convey what the feeling of the film might be.
Thank you for your film, first of all. And I was wondering, when you just said about the film that Aslan Wood is shooting, which is actually not a very interesting, very conventional film, why have you chosen that he has us as an audience go through this not very interesting film? Is that for education purposes?
It's for the idea of, again, contrasting that form of representation, which is very literal, with the painting, which again is completely abstract. So and that ultimately, there's a level of exposition that his film does present, which is also, you know, as painful as it might be to watch, it does give us the history in a very literal way. But it is the opposite of what Gorky is giving us in his painting. But what's of course so ironic, and in a way I expected it, but of course I've gotten calls, like two, and now I've seen them on YouTube, where Armenian kindergarten teachers have, in one case, asked me permission, but then the other case, they just went ahead and did it. They've edited the film so that it is just the film within the film, right? And they put in their own surtitles, you know, and so ultimately it becomes this kind of strange little mini film, which is a complete educational tool. So that's, I guess it was expected that might happen. Oh, and also, what's also odd too is, when you take that footage and you put it into kind of an algorithm which can make it black and white and scratchy and grainy. It can look archival as well. So the film that Arsene was referring to, Aurora Mardiganian's film from 1919, is often, images from that have been used in documentaries. And you feel as though that they are real images, but they're Hollywood, you know, from this early Hollywood film. So I wanted people to be really aware of like what texture and how you're supposed to read images, like what you're supposed to read. Hmm? Oh, of course not. Of course not. No, I mean, like I'm just saying.
The film was not intended. Was not. You didn't have remotely the idea that someone or some for a pedagogical or historical education purposes, the film within the film can be put together that way. But it's an interesting phenomenon that it resonates with people to go that far. So it is an indication. But I think the film within the film, other than how you're explaining about Gorky's work versus Gorky's work, two ways. It is about telling of a story, of a history, where there is the preoccupation of how do you tell that story so people are interested to listen and hear. Is it Gorky's type of artistic expression? Is it Aznavour's like of filmmaking at this point of our, you know, time? Or is it Ararat itself, which is, I think you cannot discount the whole film of Ararat from its own commentary on itself as a storytelling through Gorky's painting versus Aznavour's film, because each of them are actually referring to aspects of that history, thinking that they're going to say the most essential thing about that history. And what is essential in Ararat is not a depiction of the Armenian genocide, as in what happened, what are the moments of atrocities, what are the moments of suffering, what are the moments of inhumane sort of a plan of action on behalf of a state. Ararat talks about the outcome and the consequence of genocide when it is not accepted by its perpetrator, in this case the state of Turkey as we know it today, and it turns into denial. So our generation has to deal with that. So I think the significance of the film within the film is also a reflection on the purpose of the storytelling of Ararat in different phases of chronology of time, when you have not told your story enough times in the last 100 years or 9 years at that point, and people's attention to that, how do you get their story, which is the best way.
Yeah, and it's very interesting that you're mentioning that the emotional part of the film within the film was when the father takes the gun and goes to kill himself, because to further complicate it, a scene like that is not, it's within Edward Saroyan's film, it's within Aznavour's film, but his cinematographer has convinced him to shoot that scene in a different way. Because everything else is sort of like very classically shot. That scene is handheld, and the camera is following the father into this fire, which is a style of shooting that you don't see anywhere else in the film within the film. So then there's individual choices within that movie which might trigger different responses. So. Look, it's very prismatic, and I think that it's, when I was asked which three films am I going to show for this kind of award, I thought, okay, well, I'll show the most, you know, commercial film, I've done these commercial films like Chloe and stuff, but it wasn't really my script, so I thought of my scripts, Exotica is the most commercial. Sweet Hereafter had the most critical acclaim, and Ararat for me is the most, even though it's not the strongest film, it's the most important film I'll ever make, because I think it's just raising a lot of issues which are quite unique to the particularities of Armenian history, but my God, you're dealing with these issues here as well. You know, how do you absorb trauma? How do you move beyond a situation which is still unresolved, and how do you deal with these questions of freedom fighter or terrorist? I mean, it's funny with going to the corner, Duke Ferdinand was killed, and Principe, is he a terrorist? Is he because I heard that word yesterday in a restaurant. Someone referred to him as a terrorist. I was going, well, I thought he was a freedom fighter for Serbian. So you have all these different, so it's very exciting to kind of show it within this context, because I think there are a lot of issues that obviously have reverberations. But look, I have to tell you an honest truth about Ararat, which is that it got made because of a particular producer who had the ability to finance it if I got it made quite quickly. I was at a function at the Armenian Community Center. They were honoring me. I was off to shoot a film called they're honoring me, but Robert Land, they asked me to introduce, who would I like to have introduce me for this honor I was getting from the Armenian community? And I said Robert Lantosh, who's this producer, a distributor who I work with, and who actually produced the film that we're taking to Venice. Remember, so Robert Lantosh gets up in front of this crowd of Armenians, and I'll never forget this. I was sitting behind him, and he gets in front of the microphone, and he looks at all these people, and he's quiet, and he says, as a Hungarian Jew, I've seen so many films about Holocaust, and they have defined my understanding of what that experience means. I've never seen a film about the Armenian genocide, and if Adam is ready to make the film, I'm ready to support it. And the whole audience went on their feet, and they were like cheering, and I was about to go and shoot Felicia's Journey, and I said to Robert, like, why did you do that? That's insane. Like, I have to make this film. And he said, yeah, and you have to make it in a year, because I have access to this, money, and we have to spend it. And I'm going, really? Like, I'm about to go and shoot a film, and you're going to expect me to, like, how is that possible? But I also realized it was a unique, I had to do it. So, I put everything into this movie. Now, if I had a bit more time to actually, give myself a distance and shape it a little bit more. But I think given this extraordinary kind of, constraint, and the one thing I had written in my early 20s, a film which I put into a drawer, which is sort of the story about Clarence Usher and the story of the siege of Vannes. So I wrote it before we even met. I think it was like during that time when I first came to Toronto and I was reading this history. So I took out that script and I thought, well, and I read it, I'm going, well, this is not what I feel anymore, it doesn't represent what this history has become, and that became sort of the film within the film, and it sort of, I had to put together this story quite quickly. But that's how it was financed, and it was an odd story. Because it's funny, when I watched Son of Saul, one of the amazing things about that film is we all know that they don't have to tell us the details, because we, and one of the powerful things is we know about the grotesque Nazi death machinery. We know, we've read about it, but we've never really looked at how it happened. And to suddenly be in these places, we don't need to have anything explained, but the mind is reeling with the mundane reality of what that meant, and to see this person go through it, but nothing has to be explained to us because we know it. But that's the issue, as Arsene said, with the Armenian genocide, we don't know it, so there has to be a level of didacticism as well.